Are we ready? Good morning and welcome to the 10th meeting of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee in 2021. The first agenda item this morning is a decision to take item number 4 on our approach to the Coronavirus Discretionary Compensation for Self-Isolation Scotland Bill in private. Are members agreed?
Yes, agreed.
Thank you. We're agreed to take agenda item number 4 in private. This morning, the committee will continue its inquiry into baseline health protection measures, taking evidence from stakeholders in health and social care services. I'd like to welcome this morning to the meeting Donald Morrison, member of the Scottish Dental Practice Committee and the British Dental Association Scotland, Dr. Andrew Buist, chair of the British Medical Association GP Committee, and Dr. Donald McCaskill, chief executive of Scottish Care. Warm welcome. Thank you for giving your time to us this morning. This is the second of our 4 evidence sessions we have planned on baseline health protection measures. These measures are the main tools we are using to respond to COVID-19, which include ventilation, face coverings, social distancing, and vaccinations. This morning's session will focus on the role of baseline health protection measures in keeping health and social care services running over the winter period. We'll also consider what support might be required longer term to support your sector to recover. I'll now turn to questions, and if I may start with a few questions. Could the witnesses briefly outline the ongoing impact on COVID-19 on your sector and whether you think we're using the right approach to baseline health protection measures to help us get through this winter? Can I start with Donald Morrison, please?
Hi, good morning, committee. Just briefly, I'd like to introduce myself. I'm Donald Morrison. I'm a general dental practitioner of over 20 years' experience in the NHS. I currently work in a mixed NHS practice in Ayrshire. We're responsible for around 5,000 plus NHS patients. I think the problem or the issue that you bring here regarding how it's affected the sector. Statistics or the numbers we've got just now that we've lost over 4 million appointments at the beginning of the pandemic, and a system that was working at 100% capacity and groaning at the beginning has now been, due to mitigating circumstances to protect patients and clinicians, means that with the different baseline measures, even at its best, absolute best, you probably find that surgeries can only work to 40 to 50% of what they were doing before. So by definition, a system that was creaking before is absolutely struggling now. I think we will be a few years if we ever get back to anything like normal. And so as far as affecting the sector, I think whilst there's been a lot of support from government for the NHS part of the sector, and there have been support payments and put in place, and there's recovery packages to try and keep them running, without which genuinely would have gone to the. I think that the system is struggling so hard now just to keep up at 50% of what it was. So whilst we've had help, I think the most important thing is that ongoing from on in, we need to look very, very carefully at how the sector is going to be affected when things are supposed to try to get back up to the percentages of care that were offered in the past. I think that's all I have to say about that. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for your comments. Can I bring in Dr. Andrew Buist, please?
Thank you, convener. Well, like dentistry, our capacity has also been affected by baseline measures. We've dealt with that as we did from the beginning of the pandemic by moving to what we call a hybrid method of consulting with a mixture of remote consulting, video or telephone, with also face-to-face. And by doing that, we've actually managed to maintain the totality of the number of consultations we offer. We surveyed practices 4 weeks ago in Scotland and showed that we're providing over 500,000 appointments each week in a mixture of remote and in-person consumption. And undoubtedly, the baseline measures have impacted on how we work. The social distancing, the mask wearing, I find particularly difficult in terms of consulting. Probably not as difficult as a dentistry will do for obvious reasons, but you know, when you can see a patient face to face, it's such an important part of the consultation. The non-verbal clues, particularly with mental health issues, and I've tended to personally cope with that by seating a patient a 2 meter distance and saying, look, can we agree to take our masks off so that we can see each other face to face. So overall, it has impacted on the service that we offer, but by providing a hybrid model of consulting, we've managed to maintain overall totality of consultations, but at quite a significant cost to the general practice workforce, who I have to say are quite fatigued by this and by some of the unfair criticism that has been levelled at general practice.
Thank you. Could I bring in Dr. Donald McCaskill, please?
Thank you, convener, and thank you to members for the invitation. So the social care sector has been particularly hard hit by the different waves of the pandemic, and many of the members will be familiar with that, though I suspect familiarity has prevented us from recognising the very real immediate challenges which we are facing. So undoubtedly, the measures, the four measures that we're reflecting on today, significantly helped to make residents in care homes and individuals receiving care and support in their own home much safer. But as we've gone through the 20 months, we are evidencing real profound impact, not just by those measures, but by the whole pandemic itself. And those probably are in three areas. One is workforce. So during the first wave of the pandemic, workforce stability was in the high 80%. Very few people left the sector. They were dedicated, they stayed, they were sacrificial in their working. Now, however, we are facing in social care the biggest workforce crisis that the sector has ever experienced. And that is having a profound impact on the stability and the sustainability of the sector. The second main factor relates to the economic sustainability of the sector, which is of real concern. Given that social care is the fifth contributor to the Scottish economy as a whole, if we fail the social care sector by inadequate resourcing, and if we see, as we are seeing, more and more providers, given that Scotland has a unique small business social care makeup, if we see more of them going to the wall, as we will this winter, then that raises profound questions about sustainability. And the last factor is a whole set of additional elements which have come in the last few months. So for instance, we are seeing insurance premiums for care homes absolutely rocketing. So 2 years ago, 2019, average payment was about 3,000 to 5,000. Last year, that rose to 17,000. This year, providers are being, for the same coverage, charged £30,000 by insurance companies. That makes a small family-run business virtually impossible to sustain. Add to that, you've got real challenges with energy cost increases, challenges with transport, and all the consequences of instability brought about by the wider workforce. So there are these three factors which today are impacting on the sector, and the measures, whilst they keep people safe, are certainly not addressing those significant issues which I've just outlined. Thank you, convener.
Thank you very much, Ugunna's challenging insight into all your sectors at the moment. If I could just ask, this is probably a question for Donald McCaskill. Of course, during the pandemic, the care home visiting was stopped in order to protect the most vulnerable, and that was very difficult for all the families. However, following the petition lodged by the Care Home Relative Scotland, the Scottish Government is now planning to introduce legislation known as the Anne's Law, which will define a resident's right to see and spend time with those that are important to them. Can I ask your views on the feasibility of balancing visiting in care homes with the need for infection prevention and control measures?
Thank you, Convener. So, Scottish Care supports the broad principles of an individual resident having the right to have family, friends and others visit them. Clearly, the early measures taken by Public Health in Scotland to prevent visiting were necessary and undoubtedly saved many lives. Unfortunately, as we all know, the fact that those measures remained for longer than perhaps was necessary has resulted in real psychological, emotional deterioration and loss of life, undoubtedly, on the part of residents, and a very negative impact on the whole care home community. So as we move forward, what we continue to need to do is first and foremost remember that our primary duty is to the preservation of life, and a life lived to the fullness, not just keeping people alive, but keeping them living in a way that they would want to live. What we have as a challenge in the future is a situation where an infectious disease still exists in the community, may increase in its robustness in the community. We know that it is from the community that harm comes to an individual resident. So what we will be required to do, and this will involve all of us working together, what we will be required to do is to balance the rights of an individual to see family, friends, with the rights of other residents and the rights of staff to be protected and safe from harm. I think we're in a very different position from where we were, for instance, this time last year. The vast majority of care homes are now trying to be as flexible as possible, even during an infectious outbreak, if it's appropriately managed. But we will only move forward to try to restore ourselves to a situation that existed before the pandemic, where I could count on a couple of hands the number of instances where there was disagreement about visiting. However, as we move into winter, the threat of community transmission increasing, and therefore challenge in our care home community, increases. Last week, sadly, we lost 10 residents in our care homes as a result of COVID. That's significantly better than where we've been. But even with all our protective measures, vaccination, PPE, social distancing, we are still losing individuals. So we must never take our eye off that real challenge in the months ahead. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that. If I could ask Donald Morrison this next question, and just to give you a bit of a background, it's one case I've been made aware of in the last 24 hours, is one lady was diagnosed with a tooth abscess and a related infection back in September. Her dentist prescribed antibiotics and said that she needed to have root canal surgery, but due to the Scottish Government restrictions, she wasn't able to get an appointment for the surgery until April 2022. So this lady continues to be in a lot of pain. I'd just like to know your response to claims that private patients are being prioritised at the expense of NHS patients, and if you think that's true.
Thank you, moderator. I think that the big issue in this particular question, I'm sorry to hear about that lady, certainly on a local level, certainly in my practice, nobody's left in pain. At least there are facilities in the practices to take pain relief precautions and pain relief measures for patients that can be done without even finishing a definitive surgery. So we believe that the system will allow us to treat those patients, and any individual patient who's in that situation, I would urge them to contact their local health board and their local dentist and communicate with them, because communication is one of the big problems. We are finding that the dentists don't always know exactly what they're supposed to do in that situation. And there are quite a few patients that prior to pandemic weren't registered with the dentist anyway. And there's no there's no incentive, and there certainly isn't any, certainly wasn't a facility during the pandemic for a dentist to take on a new patient who was in that situation. But separate to that, the question of the private sector, dentistry is slightly more complicated in that each dental practice exists as an individual entity. We are essentially private contractors who work for the NHS. And so there is probably of the 1,100 practices in Scotland, only a handful, maybe 30, who are completely private. The rest are a combination of two. We call them mixed practices. They do a bit of both. Prior to pandemic, a small proportion of your work might be carried out privately, but it was the work that would then help subsidise a practice. And each business has to run, it has to function, like a hospital has to function, like a care home has to function. It just so happens that it's mixed in the one building. So what tends to happen is that the clinicians were, that revenue was cut off from the clinicians. There was NHS support and no private revenue. So those practices became almost unviable. And so to build back in strength into the sector, we need to continue to work in a joint mixed fashion to allow all those practices to continue to run, or they will fail. Obviously there's been a funding package that's assisted, and it does help the dentists. And we would say there were winners and losers. There are certain practices that have had larger payments that are doing better, and others that are doing worse. Obviously, this is something that we always try to work our way through. But the individual cases, I think the problem with individual cases is that it gets a little bit mixed up with the fact that there are always going to be cases of people who feel that they can't be seen in the way they want to be seen. So I would urge that person very, very strongly to contact any dentist in their area, and all the dentists are working really, really hard to try to deal with these situations for these patients and these people. Nobody wants to be seeing anybody in pain. The private sector, as far as dentistry is concerned, has supported and buoyed up the NHS sector for a long, long time. It's not well recognised. And unfortunately, as we come through the pandemic, it may well be that because we don't know what's happening, because of the communication with the Scottish Government, that we don't really know how things are going to go back to the treadmill of the broken system that was being reformed prior to pandemic. If we go back to that, the clinicians are unaware of how they're supposed to proceed. So they must, under all circumstances, make the system, make their practices be viable for their patients. There will always be people who fall between the gaps. But on a personal level, I can only reassure you that wouldn't happen on 90% of the dentist's watch. We are working very, very hard. But there will always be a system, certainly in medicine, where people will pay privately for something to have done faster, to use better materials, to do X, Y, and Z. And in some cases, patients will refuse to have a tooth removed, which is a treatment, which is a viable option to remove infection, treat, make the patient well, but that won't be what they want. And therefore, they have to, it sometimes takes time to get that actually done for the patient. But yes, I'm sorry to hear about that. And certainly, as far as the BDA is concerned, and as far as clinicians in that area, I'm sure there was any number of clinicians that would take a call from a patient and see them.
Yeah, thank you for that. Thanks for the guidance for that. I'm sure all of us as elected members all have these kind of issues in our inbox at the moment because it's a very challenging time. I think it would be irresponsible in the last 18, 19 months if we weren't putting measures in place to try and stop this challenging winter ahead, which we all know we are currently facing. But in the last few days, on Tuesday, the 9th of November, in Scotland, we had 2,233 new cases of COVID-19 reported. And yesterday, this rose to 3,852 new cases, which is very alarming. Can I ask the three of you, do you believe that the vaccination passports should be extended to other settings? Can I start with Dr. Buist?
Thank you for that question. Personally, I would be supportive of that. I think, you know, if I'm going into a cinema or theatre or something like that, I think it would be useful to know that the people I don't know who have been vaccinated, that would give me some comfort. So, in short, I would be supportive of the proposal to extend it.
Thank you. Can I go to Dr. McCaskill?
Well, having already said that the relationship between community transmission and what happens in a care home, or indeed what happens in somebody's own home, is now undeniable, then personally I would be in favour of the extension of the use of vaccination passports. However, I think we've got to be extremely careful that we don't see that somehow or other as a panacea to address the rising number of cases. So I have equal concern about the growing evidence. Certainly, you know, I live in Ayrshire, I wander around and I see increasing evidence of people being very lax in wearing masks. So while Scotland, thankfully, has a policy which is about encouraging mask wearing in public spaces, I think we need to look at toughening the stance on that and removing the abuses of that very, very important protective measure. So I've absolutely no doubt personally, as unfortunately, not just in terms of COVID, but an increase in respiratory conditions such as flu and norovirus, we are likely to see increased restrictions. I hope that those are brought in early enough to be sufficiently protective.
Thank you very much. And can I just finish with Mr. Morrison, please?
Thank you, moderator. The I think the big thing for the clinicians, or certainly in the dental sector, is that the other baseline measures that we use, social distancing, mask wearing, as far as dealing with our patients concerned, really just go out of the window, because you can't treat somebody, you can't social distance, and you can't wear a mask. So I think that vaccine passports, as far as I'm concerned, or we're concerned, would be that we wouldn't necessarily be in something like that, quite supportive of it, really. But I would be wary of a situation where patients weren't seeking treatment. Probably the problem with people without a vaccine passport, we worry most about the fact that that patients who have benign or have asymptomatic oral cancer that we haven't seen for a couple of years, who are the sort of people who generally can be picked up early. We can get these people just laying our eyes upon them, seeing it in the mouth and sending on to the right place is a huge thing, and picked up early saves a huge amount of money and effort and time for all the patients and all the hospitals, et cetera, et cetera. And I would be concerned about a passport stopping these types of patients. We're talking about older male patients, smokers, drinkers, who would then use it to avoid seeking treatment. And I, because for our patients, we would be a wee bit worried. But that said, I don't think that a vaccine passport, I think if patients, an education program carried out properly, where we educate the patients that, as opposed to having a vaccine passport, could take part of their clinical records that they've been vaccinated or not vaccinated. We generally treat patients, even ones that are, we assume everybody has it and treat them accordingly in social distance, whether we can, wear our own PPE, droplet. It is very difficult working in FP3, respirator masks, quite exhausting, and the profession are exhausted by it. But as far as actually our patients are concerned, I think if they are, a passport for us wouldn't make any difference, but we're certainly not against something like that. We'd worry that it would become a barrier to treatment for some people.
Okay, thank you very much. Move to questions. Murdo Fraser, please.
Thank you, convener. Good morning to the panel. I've got one question for each of the panelists, please. And I wonder if I could start with Donald Morrison. And it's a follow-up to one of the convener's questions when she relayed an experience of her constituent. And I've had a number of constituents raise other issues with me. And there's a bit of a theme, I think, here that constituents are saying that if they are private patients, they have access to treatments that are not available to them as NHS patients. That's led some to become private patients if they're in the fortunate position where they can afford to pay. But of course, there's a danger then you create a two-tier system. So I wonder if you can explain to us, you know, why is it that if you're a private patient, you can get access to appointments and treatments that you can't if you're an NHS payment?
Thank you. Thank you for that question. I would go back to my answer in that the setup, as far as each individual practice is concerned, is set up around an individual practice. Each practice is essentially a small micro hospital in itself. So during the course of the pandemic, the clinicians that are running these places need to make the practice viable, and that the private part of their income subsidizes and supports the practice. Without that, they can't, they won't exist. There's no doubt that there are large NHS practices that are running at over 100% compared to previous measurements, because they have to go so quickly to generate the income to support to get the resources into the practice. And that might sound a bit strange, but to explain it, the percentage that's paid through the COVID recovery payments or the support payments is 85% of what the gross to the practice would have been, what the building would have brought in. In order to make that work, there are some situations where being able to generate larger income from private patient or private treatment, it's not about the patient being private, it's about the treatment being carried out in a different way, and that it's using different materials or taking more time, et cetera, et cetera. But the provision for NHS, which is stipulated by the NHS Recovery Plan, is that those clinicians have to and do work in the NHS sector and provide as much as they possibly can. At the moment, we receive support of PPE to treat up to 10 patients a day. Now, in a practice on the NHS that used to maybe see 40, 50, 60 patients a day, we're only receiving the resources to treat 10 patients a day, increased time between patients, fallow time, which basically means that once you've picked up, dentistry is unique in the fact that whilst being in a patient's mouth puts you at high risk, or puts our the clinicians at high risk of catching COVID and other respiratory diseases, we also produce an aerosol in most things that we do, which disperses infection into the air. So fallow time means that you wait for a period after you've done surgery in a room that hasn't got adequate ventilation. That fallow time can be anything up to an hour before you can go back into the room. There are situations where you can increase ventilation, and we're working very hard for that, to do that, where you can get this fallow time down to 10 minutes with high-speed suction. But the process of doing that for the same, essentially the same generation or remuneration to practice, it means that the dental practices have to do more work privately to generate the same income as they were before in order to make their business viable. So if you can only see 50% of the patients that you could see before, there will inevitably be some patients that give you or report to you the perception that they couldn't be seen. That doesn't mean they couldn't be seen. There will be waiting lists. The waiting lists might be 4, 5, 6 months. No practice, no clinician will leave a patient in pain, and that won't happen. And our members are very, very careful about the fact that if I have done it in my own practice, where I have had a practice on the road on the NHS, saying they can't see a patient, we take them and see them in the NHS, help them out, pass them back. We work together as clinicians. There will always be some outliers, and I have no doubt there will be some situations where patients will need to fit in with. We still get people who say, I can't come because I'm working, or I can't do this, I can't do that. But we have to be able to recognise that somebody who's reporting this to you, and I go back to my previous answer, if there is a problem, then they need to be seen, then they will be seen on the NHS. As to whether or not the treatment is carried out immediately, and we are still in a backlog, I mean, having lost 4 million appointments and working at 50-60%, by definition, we can't be back to where we were, and it certainly isn't business as usual. Pain relief and pain management can be done. As far as the private sector is concerned, there will be dentists out there, will be other clinicians out there who have invested in a huge amount of ventilation systems, buying their own PPE, working as well as they possibly can. And patients who go to those clinicians and pay privately and have the work done, that's the same as any medical sector and has been like that for a long, long time. So, what I have to say about that.
Right. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Morrison. That's very helpful. Can I maybe turn to Donald McCaskill, please, and ask him a slightly different question? Dr. McCaskill, you were talking earlier about some of the issues in the care sector, and you specifically reference issues with workforce. I've spoken to people in the care sector who say one of the major issues has been the number of experienced and qualified staff in the care sector who are now leaving the sector to go and get jobs in other sectors like retail, for example, because the paying conditions are better. So I'm interested to understand from you how much of a issue that is, and if it is an issue, what needs to be done to fix it? How do we make sure that paying conditions in the care sector improve, that people are not leaving to get jobs elsewhere?
Thank you, Mr. Fraser. It is probably the most significant issue facing the care sector. So you're undoubtedly right in that we are hemorrhaging experienced, skilled staff, nurses and carers who are going elsewhere. So there has been a step forward with the announcement by Scottish Government of an increase in the carer salary to £10.02, taking it above the living wage. And that is the first step, but a first step in a long journey towards a destination of parity with the NHS in particular. So what we are seeing at the moment, we carried out a survey with our members over the summer, published in September. 9 out of 10 of them are struggling to recruit. People who are called to interview, 40% aren't turning up. People who are appointed, 60% leave within the first 6 months, because care is not for everybody. It is a human, it is an engaging piece of work. It is valuable, but it isn't inevitably a career for everybody. So the response to what do we need to do is multifold. So yes, we need to increase baseline salaries, because £10.02 is good. It's better than what it has been, but the same individual can go and get a job in retail or in hospitality for more money. And I'm not dissing those environments. They are extremely important to our society, but they are not demanding of an individual that they be registered, that that individual is regulated, and that that individual has to be qualified, all for £10.02. It is simply not sufficient. And I like to think that the way in which we reward those who care says something about the nature of our society. And at the moment, Scotland is failing in that relationship. But there are other factors. So the NHS and local authorities partnerships are engaged in a massive recruitment drive at the moment. So in this last week, a rural care home in Forth Valley reported to me that they have lost 3 nurses and 4 carers, all of whom have gone to the NHS in the local area. A care provider in Edinburgh has lost 15% of his home care staff because they've gone to work with the local authority. Now, we're not wanting to stop people from moving on, but if we are paying the same amount of money to somebody who's a domestic member of staff in the NHS as we are to somebody who is delivering professional skilled care, who's qualified and regulated, that lack of parity means that no matter how much we give to the social care system, we will always bleed our talent and our skills elsewhere. Undoubtedly, another factor is that those two sectors, retail and hospitality, are dramatically short of staff, in no small measure as a result of their inability to recruit internationally. So particularly in rural parts of Scotland, our members are saying to us, they are losing care staff to secure less stressful environments, which are not able to recruit internationally. There are many steps that we can take. Take home care as an example. We still have home care staff doing 15-minute visits 7 minutes of that is taken by donning and doffing your PPE safely, and they will be penalised. Their organisation will be penalised by electronic call monitoring systems established by the local authority. The way we're treating our frontline care workers is appalling and abysmal. Yes, we clapped on a Thursday for several months, but solidarity needs to be seen not just by forgetting the care workforce, but by resourcing them, skilling them with adequate training and adequate access to all that they need.
Thank you, Dr. McCaskill. Just one brief follow-up. When you talk about the increase in base salary to £10.02, I mean, have you got a sense of what level it should be at in order to try and make sure we don't face this issue with staff hemorrhaging out of the sector that you've been talking about?
At the very least, what we need to do is to create parity with the NHS. So at the moment, a care home manager under the National Care Home Contract, which is the deal with the independent sector with the state, is paid £13.50 an hour. That, as a manager, and all the responsibility compared to a carer at £10.02, we are having real problems with recruiting and holding on to senior staff because of the lack of differentials. Now, I know that the trade union sector has advocated a £15 an hour starting salary. That ultimately is, I think, where we need to move, to that level of parity. But we need significant steps in the immediate future. And I know that finance experts will say that the cupboard is bare. Well, there is a very real risk of social care collapse this winter unless we intervene with additional resource, both to retain staff, and I know that Unison has suggested retention payments to hold on to existing staff, but also a starting salary which properly recognise the amazing skilled job which carers.
Thank you very much, Dr. McCaskill. And one last question to Dr. Buist, please. Dr. Buist, you've been talking about challenges with surging demand going into the winter on GPs, and the pressure there are on GPs, simply that we don't have enough GPs in Scotland to address the public demand. I mean, clearly, you know, you can't just produce a GP out of thin air. It takes, 6-7 years to train a GP. Are we today facing a legacy of issues we should have addressed many years ago, and it's going to take a long time to catch up?
For the question, Murdo. Yes, I mean, we entered the pandemic in not a good situation. We were short of GPs before the pandemic started. This was something that we were trying to address through the 2018 Scottish GP contract. We wanted to make general practice more attractive and encourage more young doctors to come in to be a GP, and for older GPs to stay on a bit longer. We were trying to build up the multidisciplinary team, the pharmacists, the nurses and physiotherapists, mental health workers around the practice, to take away some work that the GPs were doing that could be done as well or better by other healthcare workers. But the pandemic struck. We hadn't delivered on all of these things. Premises is another big area where we have a legacy of not investing in our infrastructure, and has caught us out too in terms of the pandemic, small waiting rooms, difficulty in social distancing, difficulty having one-way systems, ventilation problems. So we weren't in a great situation before the pandemic, and it's certainly found us coming up short.
Okay, thank you, Camille.
Alex Rowley, please.
Good morning. Could I maybe start with Dr. Buist, specifically So before the winter, before the COVID, many of these problems existed. But can I ask, in terms of trying to prioritise for this winter, what is the government, or what should the government be doing that they're not doing in terms of prioritising for this winter, simply to get through this winter? But secondly, should we be looking at system change, and should we do that now, or do we have to wait and try and put all our energies into getting through the winter? And when I talk about system change, I noted that the previous chief executive of NHS Scotland had written an article in October, Paul Gray, where he talked about the need for system change. He highlighted a number of systems, the Alaskan system and the system in Sweden, and said these types of systems in primary care can deliver. So where's the balance for us as politicians, and what should the priorities be? Or can we do both?
Oh, that's thank you for that question. It's a very big question. I think system change is, we are in the middle of a pandemic. That is something that will be difficult to do for this winter. The Alaskan model is very resource intensive. If the Scottish government wanted to move to that, we could certainly look to it. I think one of the biggest problems is that we have not invested sufficiently in community health and social care. And this I'll bring you back to the David Kerr report of 2005, which ultimately said we're not providing the healthcare system that our public, our patients, the Scottish people need. With far too much focus on acute care, far too much focus on hospitals, not enough focus on access to care in the community. And, the pandemic has absolutely exposed that. It's just the nature of things in this country, like many other countries. The focus is not on community care. And same with social care, the comment Donald McCaskill earlier. We kind of take many of these things for granted, the media, public, politicians, their focus is on what is happening in hospital, what is happening in accident emergency, when really there should be much more investment and focus on the community. Now, we can fix that right now while we're still in the middle of a pandemic, but I think when we come to review and reflect on what has happened in the pandemic, these are the sort of issues that need to be explored, because we're short of workforce in the community. Our infrastructure, as mentioned to Murdo, the premises, 90% of GP premises are more than 10 years old. Some are over 50 years old. They're not really fit for purpose. We spend very little of the NHS capital on the community buildings. It tends to get put into developing facilities in the hospital. So we're still in the pandemic, and we need to learn the lessons for going forward. Not just in case there's another pandemic, but really in terms of what is most important to the people of Scotland.
Okay, thank you. Mr. McCaskill, you talked about the relationship between, I suppose, the private home care providers. It's very much a contract, and it's very much seen as an internal market. Is that part of the problem? Because when I talk to home carers, they tell me about these 15-minute visits, on the clock, off the clock. Is there a real disparity between the way that local authorities treat their own workers who are providing care and those workers who are employed by a third sector or private provider. Is there a real disparity between the two? And would a starting point perhaps be to look at where the best practice is and try and get towards that?
So, yes, there is certainly a disparity, and it's a disparity with hypocrisy at its heart. So if we take home care as an example, the same electronic monitoring systems which are used on staff in the third and independent sector are very rarely used on staff employed by a local authority. One local authority this week is advertising jobs for home care staff at £14 an hour, which is more than a care home manager gets in the third or independent sector. So there is significant disparity. And if you take care homes as an example, last week, two independent studies evidenced that a reasonable cost of delivering 24/7 nursing care home provision would be between £1,000 and £1,200 a week. The national care home contract, that's what the state pays for somebody funded by the state in a care home, is only £750. There is a huge gap. The average local authority care home cost is closer to £1,300. So yes, there is a gap, and it's a gap which, unfortunately, those who are self-funders in care homes and those increasingly funding their own care in the community are having to match. And that is unfair, and it's inequitous, especially for women and men who are unfortunate enough to develop dementia and who, in the later stages of their illness, will have no choice but to receive the 24/7 specialist care in a care home. Were they to have unfortunately developed cancer, all that care and treatment substantially through the NHS and community and primary and secondary services would be paid for them. So inequity is like a stick of rock in our health and care system, dependent on condition and dependent on who delivers that care. But in the end of the day, Mr. Rowley, the worker, the carer, gives the same compassion even if she is not rewarded or recognised in the same way.
So following up for that, and it also would be Dr. Buist as well, last week the guidance was given, and I think NHS Tayside was highlighted as good practice, where people approaching an accident emergency are then referred to wherever they should have gone, it's suggested. Much of that, and I saw Dr. Buist make comment on this as well, but much of that suggests that these people are going to be referred back to the community. But we seem to have a crisis within the community. You know, regularly on a daily basis, I have people contact me to tell me the difficulty they've had in securing appointments, either with a GP or at a medical practice. The numbers, waiting lists for social care, where people have been assessed as needing social care in the community, home care, is growing. So, one, is that pouring pressure on the accident emergency, because that's eventually where people will turn up? And two, is it acceptable that accident emergency can keep referring them back to the community setting when the community setting can't cope? We'll start with Dr. Buist.
Thank you. I'm happy to take that question. I support the principle of redirection. It's operated in Tayside for more than 10 years. And the Tayside public broadly know that if they have a non-A&E type problem, they shouldn't go to accident emergency. If you have had back pain for 2 months, it's not an appropriate thing to go to. Call decision maker will redirect you. I suggested this to Jean Freeman in July last year as a better model to address the 4-hour wait than the redesign of urgent care, which I do not support. I think that as a model, it needs to be well communicated and understood by the public and introduced gently. And as the point you're making, There needs to be places for those patients to go. Now, that might be to the community pharmacy, and increasingly pharmacy is a useful model, or it may well be to the general practitioner. Now, as I mentioned earlier, general practice in Scotland is offering over 500,000 appointments every week. That is one person in every 10 in Scotland is having a clinical consultation at their general practice each week. But our capacity is finite, and at some point, very often just now, it is exhausted. And I go back to my earlier point, we do not invest sufficiently in our community healthcare capacity. Right now, we are short of general practitioners and short of practice nurses and short of pharmacists and physiotherapists working in general practice. So we need to continue to deliver the new GP contract, which is about increasing the number of GPs and increasing the number of multidisciplinary team members attached to practices to meet that demand, so that patients don't have to go to A&E when it's not appropriate to do so.
And Dr. McCaskill.
Agree with what Andrew has just said. What happens, as you will know, and as other members of the committee will know, is that if somebody cannot be supported in the community because home care services don't have workers who are able to do the job, then those care packages are handed back or they can't start. A huge pressure is put on our colleagues in community nursing and in general practice. And at the other end, if somebody needs to and is ready to be discharged from hospital and care homes don't have staff or capacity, or home care doesn't have capacity, then the whole system is blocked. And at the moment, it sometimes feels as if we've got a 25-year-old car and we've decided to spray paint it, but we're ignoring the fact that the engine is broken down. Part of that means that we have to start working as a whole system. And unfortunately, the way in which we prioritise attention to secondary, particularly acute care, means that social care and to some extent primary care is left on the sidelines. We need to start talking. For instance, we've not had a strategic national gathering of individuals in the sector, social care and health, for some considerable time. Now, it may be that social care partnerships and providers from the public sector are talking to health colleagues, but I know for certain people like me and my colleagues in the third sector, who deliver 70% of social care in Scotland, are simply at the moment not at the table. And that includes the failure to learn from the pandemic to be present in terms of pandemic response.
And just finally and quickly on that point, so I've found that where I've raised with NHS 5 around social care, the chief executive has been very quick to tell me that I really need to speak to the chief executive of Fife Council. When I speak to the chief executive of Fife Council, he is quick to refer me to staff 3-4 levels down and tell me that they'll get back to me. Nobody seems to be taking responsibility. So is the health and social care partnerships, the joint integrated boards, are they fit for purpose, and do they have the capacity to actually meet the challenges that we face over the coming months? Dr. McCaskill.
I think that is a huge question, and obviously the consultation on the National Care Service is in part about redesigning the system of governance around health and social care. My primary point at the moment is that if we are to get through this very challenging winter, which we've now started, the whole system, both at local and increasingly national level, needs to start including the third and in the independent sector. In parts of Scotland, there is tremendous partnership working, but in other parts of Scotland, the NHS tail is wagging the social care dog.
Thank you.
Ryan Whittle, please.
Thank you, convener. Good morning to the panel. Can I start just by asking a very general question. I think I always think that if we're going to have a working healthcare sector, we need to look at firstly at the morale and the health of the healthcare professionals that work within that sector. So, can I ask that general question around where we are in terms of the morale and the health of the healthcare professionals currently working, compared to what they were pre-pandemic? I'll just start with Mr. Morrison, if I could.
Thank you for the question. I think that probably to describe the morale to be at low is a huge understatement. The profession itself is just struggling under the cosh of the pandemic. But prior to that, I think we were in a system that had already been recognised as not fit for purpose. So we were in the process of trying to reinvigorate and reinvent dental. We've been told that the process isn't going to be addressed any further. So, because to make large changes, to quote the CDO at this point would be, or the health minister, that this would be a problem for us to do or try to resolve and change, reform the system. So if I could go back to Mr. McCaskill's analogy of the 25-year-old car getting a respray, our 60-year-old car, which was due respray, is now not even getting its respray. We are probably at a point where recently polled practitioners, 80% of them have suggested they will reduce their NHS commitment, and 30% of those have said they'll be looking for early retirement and to leave the system. So I think that morale is really low with the clinicians. It's also particularly low with staff. We're getting stories now of practitioners who have had maybe three or four staff in a small practice just turn around and say, we need to move on. They're getting jobs in hospitals, they can get jobs in Tesco's, they get paid more. Reduce the problems that they have working in PPE of FFP3, where you are working in a respirator mask for large quantities at a time. So we're losing nurses, we're losing dentists, and there doesn't seem to be much that's bringing anything back in. So yeah, I think morale is particularly low just now. And I think the question, I can't really go on more about that, if I'm honest.
Dr. Boost.
The question, morale is down in general practice. People working in general practice are tired. I'm tired. As well as talking to you guys, I work 2 days a week in general practice. We've been on the front line of this pandemic since March last year, and it's been unrelenting. It's been constantly changing. We've had the early phase, the shielding, the problems of secondary care, having longer waiting lists for outpatients, operations. That causes back pressure into general practice, rising levels of mental health issues, stress, anxiety, depression in patients, and that problem lands very much on general practice. Being aware demand has outstripped our capacity despite our valiant efforts, and the issue of criticism that has been unfairly levelled at general practice by certain sections of the media and certain politicians is very demoralising when you are absolutely doing your best. And unfortunately, in some cases, that has led to verbal abuse from patients towards practices, staff. 88% of practices reported that they were aware of verbal abuse in the previous month. So we're not in a good place just now. I do worry about retention of the workforce. I know many GPs are looking at whether they're going to stay in the profession or whether they might reduce their time commitment for their own personal well-being. So we're not in a good place just now as we face this acknowledged to be most difficult winter ahead of us.
And thank you. And finally, Dr. McCaskill.
I think morale in social care is just through the floor, and a bit similar to what Dr. Booth said, social care workers were on the front line, have been on the front line, are still on the front line, and they are absolutely exhausted. They are literally running on empty. And people have kept going through all the challenge physically and emotionally because they felt it was their obligation, their responsibility, both to those who they support, but also to their colleagues. And part of that ability to keep going was a sense of value. But as time has gone on, that value has diminished and it's depleted. The obscenity which Operation Copper is for care home staff has directly resulted in numerous staff leaving the sector. We all want answers to the loss of lives, but the victimisation, the disproportionate use of power by the Crown Office is shameful and it shames our nation. So we have to draw a line under. We're still having people who, 20 months after initial interview and evidence gathering for people who died in care homes, still don't know what is going to happen with that information. So our care sector, our care workforce in the community and in care homes is feeling hugely demoralised, physically and emotionally. I have the privilege of chairing Scotland's working group on our national bereavement charter. The impact of grief and loss on those in the social care sector has been hugely significant during the pandemic. It is now becoming something of very real concern. Individuals are experiencing what clinically is described as prolonged grief syndrome. It is a trauma which they have experienced and which has led, and I am absolutely sure, will lead more to leave the sector. Now, you address that sense of trauma by appropriate mental health support, but you significantly address it also by making a woman or a man, a nurse or a carer, feel valued, respected, wanted, and appreciated. And unfortunately, the whole of our society singularly has failed to do that for frontline social care.
I thank the panel for your answer. I think it's certainly a concern. I've always thought the first step in, should always be to look after the health and well-being of those who look after us. Can I turn specifically to Mr. Morrison there? I mean, I think you described a system that was creaking and was not working pre-pandemic, and now you're suggesting they're now down about half capacity at the moment. Can you catch up while the COVID measures are in place? I think that's, you know, first and foremost, do we have to just accept that under the current conditions it will be nigh on impossible to catch back up to where we were pre-pandemic? And what needs to happen to return to that sort of balanced operating system? And linked to that, is there an opportunity here to reassess and redesign the system from the learnings from COVID?
Thank you. In answer to your first question, no, I don't believe we can catch up in its current form. Recently, we've been told by the CDO and Scottish Government that we will return to the previous remuneration method, which is a thing called the Statement of Dental Remuneration, the SDR, which is a fee per item process where the clinicians or the practice is paid for what they do on the patients. It's a really old system. As I said, it has been around since the 50s, 1950s, that is. And it's based on getting in patients fast, getting them turned around, getting them out the door, and doing any treatment that they need as quickly as possible. It's not nice for patients. It's really difficult to work under. We refer to it as the NHS treadmill. And prior to COVID, at the end of 2018 to 2019, we started to talk about that oral health improvement review, and we were looking at possibilities. It wasn't, the negotiations maybe weren't going very well, but they were at least being acknowledged that we needed to take more time and we needed to concentrate on prevention. I think the system that we have just now through the pandemic, I would like to obviously acknowledge the support that the NHS sector has had from government and the dentists that have continued to work under the recovery package or the maintenance package they've kept that afloat. That so that maintenance package, it left in place, which is to be taken away from us, we were advised in April of next year will be gone, and we're supposed to return to fee per item. Now, if you can only go at half the pace, you won't be able to address those, certainly deal with your backlog, and you will then be going at half the pace from then on. So I think that to actually realistically deal with the backlog, the answer is quite simply no. But if we were in a situation where there was more dentists provided, there was better, I mean, we have fewer dentists being educated and trained, we don't have it. Patients coming in. We used to have a lot of dentists coming from overseas, Europe, etc. But Brexit, that's certainly, we have a lot fewer of that. That being addressed would be, may well be a positive thing. Staffing from overseas as well was a thing that the sector benefited from, which we're suffering from now. As far as the baseline measures are concerned, I think the mitigating in general practice is difficult. We've always expected that. Certainly from a personal point of view, that you, one of your issues was when you went into the profession was that you would be exposed to a lot of respiratory viruses, and it's part of the, it's the nature of working in a person's mouth and being close to them. The problem I find interesting is the fact that if you took COVID completely out of the arrangement just now and you went back to what we are waiting for, we haven't had the guidance yet. We're waiting for IPC guidance, which is infection prevention control guidance, which was reviewed last year and has still not been published. Scotland down to the professionals. So we don't really know what we're going to have to do. We at the moment we currently keep patients outside in waiting rooms, and when the waiting rooms are small, we keep them waiting in cars. We escort them on and off the premises. We do hand washing hygiene. That takes a colossal amount of time. There's follow, as I talked about before, where if you're working with a patient, you need to allow the time for the droplets to drop so that you can then clean the area. We've tried to look at different options for that, but at the moment we are draping the place in plastic. We have ventilation, which is planning, trying to get 10 air changes in the room, get follow time down, but that also drags all the warm heated air out of the building. So there's increased heating costs. There is nurses working in PPE wrapped in plastic at one point and then freezing cold because you can't heat the room on the other side. God knows what we're doing to the environment, to the whole thing. So I think that trying to keep these mitigations, these in to protect from COVID, I think ultimately is costing a lot of other problems in other parts of the sector. I think that I think having a process for ventilation could be effectively increased. We've had funding from the government, £5 million, to allow us to help with practice, but that's actually down to about £1,500 per surgery, and I've yet to find anyone who can actually put effective ventilation in for that. Some practices, lots of these practices are in old buildings. I've had colleagues who put in this adequate ventilation, cost them to the tune of £15,000 to £20,000, you know, to do that. But those things maybe need to be in place to make the environment safer for clinicians and nurses. But the concept of a redesign of the system was what we've been pushing for pre-pandemic for the last, almost as long as I've been in dentistry, it's over 20 years. But the redesign of the system is, I think, really important. We've been advised that the redesign at this point would be a poor thing to do because we're I have been advised that at the moment we're just trying to get, Scottish Government wants us to get back to our backlog, but if that's never going to happen or not going to happen, then we need to have some sort of redesign. I think that the system needs to keep its the support payments to practice at the moment if you want to keep the NHS sector alive. or you will or it will be lost. I think with all of the things I've said, the biggest, most important thing we have just now is we have a huge, huge lack of communication. As a clinician, obviously, I hear certain things through my contact with the British Dental Association earlier, but my colleagues hear things through social media. In fact, we get absolutely no consultation with many of the decisions that have been made through the last 18 months. So communication, even if we all accept that we're in a situation that is almost untenable, but we will work really hard together, we would feel as a profession that we're working with government rather than it feels like it's against government. The concept of being asked constantly why we're not getting on with things, it should be business as usual, and it just isn't business as usual. So for that to be put out in press, for that to be put into the public domain by our politicians, I suppose, certainly the media haven't helped, but we are seen as the bad guys, and we just desperately are not. We're working very, very hard not to be like that. I think ventilation, assistance with that, acknowledgement of the situation. The one thing that is probably very unpopular, and I might say this is not necessarily the BDA's position, but as far as dentistry is concerned, the two-tier service, which nobody really wants to have, all the dentists would love to work in the NHS and do their work in the NHS if it was recognised properly. But I think that a two-tier service would be the thing that would end up clearing backlog of pain and problems, in that pain relief, teeth removal, abscess, there's a lot of horrible things in people's mouths that could be helped with a base level service that I wonder if we can find a way to do that more efficiently, more carefully and more quickly for our patients. Just because I suspect that the next 2 years is going to be really, really hard. 2 to 3 years is going to be very difficult. But I suspect that might be an unpopular idea. But yes, catch up, no. Redesign, yes.
Thank you. Can I turn to Dr. Buse? I think, you know, it's recognised pre-pandemic we were short of some 860 GPs. We were working towards a multidisciplinary teams, and we were working towards a move towards community care. And of course, a lot of that has been put on hold because of the pandemic. But one of the things in the pandemic is the rapid deployment of technology. And I wonder what you think going forward as a recovery from the current crisis. Whether the continued deployment of technology would help doctors to cope with the backlog and potentially development of future policy.
Question. Before I answer, I wanted to come back on the previous question in support of what Donald McCaskill was saying. I think I'm here to speak on behalf of general practice, but I think one of the clearest messages we need to the Scottish Parliament is that social care is the top priority to resolve this winter. I joined the Health and Sport Committee on Tuesday, and that was the outstanding issue. We must do something to support the workforce there. Otherwise, the back pressure that will create in the rest of the system will take down anything else that we try and do. So that is one of the top messages I think we need to take from here. Regarding technology helping with catch up, in general practice we largely deal with today's work today. If you have to wait a week to see a GP, that's quite a long time. We don't have a 6 month waiting list or 12 month waiting list to see your GP. We try and deal with problems right now. The area that has probably most suffered through the pandemic will be long-term condition management, chronic disease management, you might call it, things like diabetes, health management, heart disease, adjusting blood pressures and blood sugars and things like that. I think that's one area that we've not been able to provide as much support to as we normally would. And technology, I think one of the questions I thought you might ask me today is over the consulting model. Then we were moving to more remote consulting before the pandemic. And indeed, we were being encouraged to move to video or telephone consulting before the pandemic. And then when the pandemic struck, we were particularly encouraged to do it because of the benefits of infection control. So I think we're going to continue with a hybrid model of consulting, a mixture of face-to-face or in-person when that is appropriate to do so. But when a patient's problem can be managed by telephone, many patients appreciate being able to have the problem dealt with quickly by telephone. They may be at work or they may be away from home. It saves them time. It is efficient for the service, and it's also environmentally friendly. So I think technology in terms of remote consulting is here to stay. Other methods of monitoring remotely, technology, I think, you know, we need to get the basics right before we can adopt a lot of the ideas that are bubbling around. And right now, the basics are not right. So the telephone is fine. Video consulting is coming in. Other methods could come in, but we need to get our basics sorted before we move on to adopting large scale technology, I think.
Thank you. I'm sorry, I'm just conscious of time. We've got 14 minutes until we've got 2 minutes silence at 11 o'clock, and we've still got two members to go to. So can we move to John Mason, please?
Thank you, convener. Can I just say I'm disappointed that some members have had considerably longer to ask questions than some of the rest of us. Mr. Whittle just had 22 minutes, and Jim Fairley and I now have to share 9 between us. I'm also on the Finance Committee, and we've been spending quite a lot of time on preventative spending, and that's been going on for quite some years. I think this is the anniversary of the Christie Commission and so on, and the point has been made, especially I think by Dr. Buist already this morning, that maybe, you know, there has been a concentration on hospital buildings rather than on in the primary care sector, where all three of yourselves are. Have you any suggestions as to how we take that forward? Should we be trimming, assuming that there's not going to be extra money for anyone for in total, should we be trimming a bit of money off the hospital budgets and putting more into primary care? I'll start with you, Mr. Buist, if I can.
Thank you for that question. Yes, we should. The government announced a £30 billion programme of investment in the buildings of the health service recently, 10-year plan to deliver that. And I've said to Humza Yousaf, general practice primary care needs to get their fair share of that. The money tends to be devolved to the health boards for them to decide how to spend that money, and they spend a vanishingly small amount on general practice, and I suspect dental community services as well. We need to have a fair share of that investment. As I said earlier, more than 90% of the 1,000 odd general practice buildings across Scotland are more than 10 years old. They've been found in many cases severely wanting by this pandemic in terms of the ability to manage patients safely in large numbers due to, you know, cramped conditions and ventilation being inadequate, waiting areas being too small. So there's an absolute desperate need. One of our top priorities for the community to get a fair share of that investment.
And maybe from the dental angle as well?
I think it's a difficult question to answer, as we're not necessarily privy to the numbers that are kept for health boards. As off the top of my head, I can think that the Scottish spend in dentistry is about £400 million. 775 million of which comes from patient charges that we bring in, the practices bring in themselves, but all of these practices, with few exceptions, are in privately owned buildings that belong to practices. So the system is so stacked in the sort of private sector working as independent contractors, it's very, very difficult to kind of, I wouldn't imagine that taking budgeting for dentistry away from hospitals was the way that I would do it, but I don't know the budgeting, so I'd have to pass to the others and say I can't answer that question for you.
Okay, and I'll just ask one further question in the light of time. We talked about vaccine passports, and the suggestion has been that staff in certain settings, for example, some care home companies, I believe, are making it compulsory to have their staff vaccinated. I just wonder if you all feel that would be the right way to go. Dr. McCaskill?
As a national organisation, taking the stance that what we need to do is to convince, persuade, answer the questions, give assurance to staff. In Scotland, our figures are astonishingly high, both in terms of the first dose, second dose of vaccination. What we want to do is continue to address any anti-vaccination messaging, which has become fairly dominant in social media. I don't think it is an issue in Scotland at the moment, and I would like to hope that as we move forward, we are able to continue to build confidence amongst the workforce. I am very aware that colleagues in England are talking in the last 24 hours of losing 50,000 care staff and potentially 120,000 in the extension of vaccination requirement into the NHS. It's not a step either in terms of workforce management or to give assurance to both staff and residents in a care home, which we are contemplating at the moment.
OK, thanks, Convener. I'll leave it at that.
Jim Fairley.
In the interest of time, folks, first of all, I'd like to say on a personal note, I'd like to give the healthcare my personal thanks because my family are currently using various methods of the National Health Service and are working in the National Health Service. You have given us a huge amount to think about today. And to be perfectly honest, we've only got 4 minutes left. Any one of the members of the panel today or of the committee today could have taken the full 85 minutes because there's a massive amount to get through. So I'm not going to ask any wee pointed questions. The biggest issue that I had was the fact that there were the National Health Service in England were bringing in the compulsory vaccination system. And that was the biggest issue for me. Is that something that would be accepted here in Scotland? And how do you feel about it? And I know, Mr. McCaskill, you've just answered it. How do you feel about that same question, Mr. Morrison and Mr. Buist?
If I can come in there, I think we'd be very, very... we feel that the messaging, in the same way that Dr. McCaskill was saying, messaging, public messaging is really, really important to try to act anti-vax because we agree very strongly with the vaccination programme. I would have to say right at this current moment, anything that is likely to cause staff to leave or have to stop is terrifying for most clinicians. And most clinicians would say, I wouldn't do anything that's going to affect my staffing at this moment in time. Quite happy to promote it, and we feel it's a very positive and important thing. And I've got full uptake in my practice. I can't overemphasize how important that is. However, we don't support compulsory vaccination. That in mind, we've always been compulsory vaccinated with Hep B for years and years and years, and it's never been a problem. But anything that would affect the workforce just now, I think I would be really concerned about.
Dr. Buist.
I could endorse my two colleagues here in terms of what they said. I think education and persuasion are the best ways to encourage staff members to take up the vaccine. I would be seriously concerned about the impact of this will have on workforce. And as we've already said, that they are very, very vulnerable just now. We'll see what happens in England. I think we should think very, very carefully before we institute a similar requirement.
I'll leave it there, Convener. In the interest of time, there's no danger of getting into anything substantive. So, once again, gentlemen, my thanks for the service that we've had. I know it's been a hellish difficult time for you all. And I mean that. It's not a platitude. I mean it quite sincerely.
Yes, thank you. I'd like to thank all the witnesses for their evidence today and giving us an insight to all the challenges that you're currently facing. If witnesses would like to raise any further evidence with the committee, they can do so in writing, and the clerks will be happy to liaise with you about how to do that. The committee's next meeting will be on the 18th of November, when we will continue to take evidence on baseline health protection measures. That concludes the public part of our meeting this morning. I suspend the meeting to allow the witnesses to leave and to move the meeting into the private for the next agenda item. Thank you.